So hi, my name is Rhonda Zaharna, and I'm at the School of Communication, and I teach teamwork. And before I get started, I just got to know who you are, but just so that everybody else will know who you are, can we just go around and say just the name, and then which school or department, and if you use Teams, just if you use Teams. So I'm Rhonda Zaharna, and I love Teams, and I use them.
I'm Jason Snyder from SETS, School of Education, and I use Teams.
I'm Judy Spector, COCA, and it's all about Teams.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm from the business department. I'm interested in using Teams. I tried once really before.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Lily Brandon, and I'm here to learn about Teams.
Cool.
If I'm using them correctly.
Okay.
Blake Bennett, public health, and trying to do some better, I guess.
Okay.
Alison Box-Pierke, in stuff also, but in health promotion, and I will be using Teams, but it's my first time, so.
All right. This is my first time doing CTRL.
Dean Freed with the School of Freshman Ed Studies, and I've used Teams to some degree before.
Okay.
Tommy Giannini, FIS, and I'm trying to get from groups to Teams.
Super. Yes, there is a difference. Yes. What is the difference between groups and teams? A group is an individual, random. They do their work, and it's like an assembly line. We all put it together. A team, they work together so that their differences complement each other, and you get a synergistic effect. Instead of just adding, you get more than you ever expected. So that's that synergistic effect. Did we get everybody? Okay, so teams, we said it's all about, Judy, when you said it's all about teams, it has become all about teams. That it's now the number two skill that employers are looking for. Teams, and this was some of the research, teams outperform the best individual 97% of the time. We're moving from network, we're moving from hierarchies to networks, and the information overload, teams can manage information much more. And the last bit of information on 1986, they ask people what percent of what you need to do, what of the information that's in your brain do you have to complete it? And it was in 1986, 75% of what they needed to know was in their brain. Now, people say, I only know about 15%. The other part, I need to go and get it from other people. So, teams have become very important. And I have been working with the students, and I've been teaching teamwork in School of Communication. And the student experience that I had was wonderful. But last semester, and this was the first time I was teaching it again for some time, I found out toward the end of the semester, I'm reading their journals, and I'm having a great time with the students, and the students start telling me about their experiences in other classes. And it was not so happy. And then I also am finding out from my colleagues that their experience with students and teamworks was not so happy. So that's where I got this idea of, wow, we gotta find out what's going on with teams and how to make it a better experience for both the students and the professors. And so that's why I put together this session. So I'd like to make this a working session in teams, and I put together packets for you. I'm big. I'm green. I put green paper in. But in working with teams, and what I'd like to do is get your perspective on this. And just on the top page, I have a couple of questions. And if I could just get on the, I'd like you just to go, to take the first question and to write down. If I could just get 2 points for each. Like, why do you want students to work in team? What's the whole idea behind that? And then 2, what's the biggest challenge? If you haven't done teams, what do you anticipate may be the biggest challenge? And then, if you have been working in teams, what are tips that you found that have been good? Little notes. Okay. What I'm going to do, and one of the things that I wanted for this on this session is 1, informal, but 2, to do or learn by doing. So I'd like to put y'all, if you can go into 3, and we have a couple of new people. We went around before and said our names, so your name?
Steve Downsell, SIS.
Steve Downsell, SIS.
And I'm Carly, I'm a graduate student in the psychology department.
Super.
Eugene from Quebec School of Business.
Quebec School of Business, okay. So since I think about groups just 3 or 4, you can have, just there could be like 3 of the members in your team.
I'll come over here.
Great.
How should we do this?
Who is Quebec? Quebec. Are y'all Quebec? Or what was?
Yeah.
You are.
I'm Quebec.
Quebec.
No.
Quebec.
Okay.
Come over, Quebec.
All right.
Nice to meet you.
Thank you.
And one of the things that in going into groups,
there's
like
3.
You can
think of 4.
You're it.
All right. One of the things in teams is, and this is what I do with the students, is make it so you can see each other and feel comfortable with each other. You're going to get a back cramp. Get comfortable. And one of the techniques is pair and share. So pairing or teaming and sharing. And I'd like for you to share why you want students to work in teams and then challenge. If you just share some of your answers with each other.
Are you going to want us to present something from our group for them?
I might, but I might go around it just fine. But the big thing is for to share among each other, with each other.
It's after participation as opposed to the Lexington.
Yeah, that's exactly the same. I came in generally, and so that, you know, policy design and policy. And so I think that's just the way to go. But I also think, you know, a lot of what we do is thinking out loud, like decision making under different conditions. And so, you know, the market is a lot of work. Open for another, but it's sort of like different sort of.
I think it's more academic and active, despite all the trends.
Yeah, I put improved work product, increased participation, and students learn better through application of knowledge. Foundations course.
So that covers methodology.
Have you make sure
that it does? It's the a little bit. So we don't go into depth in that.
The role playing is right on there.
The foundations course is
why are some of the reasons y'all are putting in teams? Can I get one or two? Why some of the reasons putting in teams? What was the one that y'all had? What was the reason for putting in
teams? Current field order going that way.
Field going that way? That was the unanimous? what about cooperative learning? Do you think that they learn better? The students learn better? Do you know that, yes, the cooperative learning, they're finding out that, one, students do learn better. There's a better student-student interaction. It creates a better student-professor interaction. It also helps on retention. And when the students like each other, they tend to work harder and produce better work. And this is a whole new trend that I was just beginning to learn about. I was approaching it from teamwork, from the business aspect, and just stumbled on this whole thing of cooperative learning. Usually we learn in like sitting in a row, and that's the individualist, or curving on a grade, that makes people highly competitive. They find when students work together to help each other to learn, and this cooperative learning, how much more beneficial it is. And I heard that Michigan State is trying to do it university-wide to get them to go into cooperative learning. So, and that's going to be my personal mission. I've been here for 20 years. This is like, it's going to be my mission in the future is to get AAs to move toward cooperative learning. So, watch me on a tangent. So, what's a big challenge? What's a big challenge? Big challenge? Challenge.
No, we were saying the pre-writer problem.
Pre-writer problem. And by the way, I'd love if y'all tear this off and leave it with me. It's part of my own book. The pre-writer. Whatever.
I'm kind of related to that. I'm not even finishing the discussion, but getting them prepared to work in the teams, because I found that. You know, I was somewhat predictive about when I was going to be using sort of teamwork. Of course, I'm saying I don't know if I'm not going to lead the team. And I mean, supposed to improve accountability, but it didn't appear to.
this was the one thing that I found, I mean, like, it took my breath when I saw it, is that the professors want the students to do the academic, but unless you prepare the students and coach them along in the teamwork, it just doesn't work. It doesn't work. And the thing that they've said in the research is that you have to get the students, you have to pay as much attention to the teamwork as the actual thing that you're teaching. That they're just not going to produce on their own. So that was, screenwriter and prep. I heard somebody said trust, that students are afraid of making mistakes. Did I hear that? I thought I heard that. My ears perked up. All right, it was my imagination. Yes.
I have another, I didn't say that or anything, but when I try to get my students to work together, it's time management. So unless it is in the classroom, I don't know if I'm getting this right, is it teamwork in the classroom or also it implies that they have to work outside, get together, and continue teamwork? Because I'm not very clear.
Both.
Okay.
Both.
So time management.
Oh, then that's so important, especially now because the students are stressed. They're stressed as it is at the time. Okay. Yes.
It's really important for the students to have clear instruction as to what their output should be.
Okay.
So they don't have to waste time trying to figure it out.
Okay. So clear instructions, instructions. And these are the challenges, having the challenges. What about tips? And I'm going to go through the challenges. In fact, that's what the whole session is about, is giving tools and tips on dealing with challenges. What about tips? Any personal tips? Yeah.
I have a couple. One is I have the student teams create their own identity, so I have them make a name for their team.
Okay.
And the other one is I make sure they get together just to talk about things, like an article or something, beyond like having to do a paper or something like that, so they can get into a sort of an informal type of atmosphere with each other before they have to start dividing up work.
And we're going to talk about why those two are so critically important. Mm-hmm. We're going to talk about that. It's the socio-emotional, it's the two dimensions of teams. Yeah.
My sense was that a lot of them were worried about how they were going to be assessed, and so like if they didn't talk a lot in front of me, they were worried that they would, their grade would suffer, and so there was like a dysfunctional, impulse to always be talking.
Uh-huh.
And so I gave them a backup where I said, send me your notes beforehand,
uh-huh,
so that even if you don't get to say something or you feel like it's repeating what other people were saying,
uh-huh,
I would see that you had done the work.
Mm-hmm.
And so they didn't feel like they always had to say something just to,
get attention.
Get attention, yeah.
Okay. Yes.
You go ahead.
I have a question rather than tips.
Okay.
So it's just always I was wondering what would be the best way to form a team or a group. So I can think of two ways. One is let them,
uh-huh,
have team members,
okay,
whatever they want.
Mm-hmm.
And usually it becomes friends or close friends or friends and
so
they plug together.
Mm-hmm.
And then they know exactly what will bring up the best work. So they want to only work with the best students in,
mm-hmm,
the classroom.
Mm-hmm.
And then the problem becomes usually students who are quiet or shy,
mm-hmm,
or don't have many friends, they are,
mm-hmm,
left out, and then,
mm-hmm,
nobody wants to work with them. So one way, should I let them have a group, whatever they want, or should I intervene and then divide people into certain groups, like,
mm-hmm,
in my case, the classroom, the course actually have from freshmen to the upper level students, and
mm-hmm,
all kinds of background of students, international students, American students, and really diverse. So should I intervene and then divide a team relatively equal in terms of their talent and capabilities and etc. So I don't know what
I want you to hold on to that. And I've noted that, but and also that was the very first question I had for our discussion session. Y'all had questions for me. I had a bunch of questions for you. And that was one of the first ones, was how are you going to assign and form teams? So hold on to that, and we are going to get to that in the discussion.
And that was going to be my tip.
Your tip, okay.
In terms of assigning teams, depending, what I do is, it's course specific, but you want, we have a simulation, so I make sure I have at least a finance major, an accounting major, marketing, different expertise or different strengths. And then within that, they will go into a team.
Mm-hmm. We're going to talk about that in the discussion. How do you match diversity to get creativity? But it's going to be different for, you were doing the psychology?
Yeah.
And it'll be graduates or undergraduates?
Undergraduates
is a different thing because they're the identity and the sense of security. So how do you match diversity with having the students feel secure enough? So we'll get to that, because it is a balance that they're finding. So I'm hearing a lot of things, and rubrics we're going to get to at the end. Assigning, we'll get to the end, and the discussion, we'll come back to that. The biggest thing for the students, do you know what the students' biggest concern?
Grade.
Related to grade.
Equity.
Yeah. We go to class, we get into class, and these professors put us into these teams, and our grades are at stake, and we have no idea who we're working with, and how can I trust the other person? This is my grade, and it's really, I'm depending on the other person for my grade. And it's a huge matter of trust. And then we get, the reason I put this in a triangle, because we get into this triangle dilemma. The students don't know the other person. Yes, everybody's connected. And yes, maybe they've been going through the sequence together, but they're looking at each other, and they don't really know about the person. And you know, we've all been in situations where we've been with colleagues for years and we really don't know them. Or if we've worked with them, I mean, you suddenly get into this group and like, oh, I didn't know they were like this. So trust, then not knowing the person, and then, forgive me, these are undergraduates or graduates, and most of us have been around the block a couple of times, and we worked out our own little kinks and gotten to know our kinks and how to work with other people. The students are great with communication technology, but when it comes to social skills with other students or other people their age, or not stare, just don't make eye contact. And so what I do is kind of work backwards, is we go into how do you start learning about other people. And so I'm going to go through some tools and techniques, and you can modify if they do it. Oh, I put it backwards. Did I do it? I did it. It should be. If you see this one, student bingo. Thank you. Yeah, I love this. If you rip off the front page and give it to me, I love it. If you just rip off the front page, it's sort of like underneath it. Oh, you're going to want to keep that first one. Yeah. Thank you. All right, y'all see people bingo? And it says people bingo at the top. Sorry. People bingo. So for this, really simple icebreaker activity, and I think we have time to do it. Do we have time to do it? Y'all want to do it? Or I can tell you about it, because we have another one that's fun too. This one, and I start with this one, where it's the circle, and they physically have to get up out of their seat, walk around the room, and we go through this. What do you do when you talk to somebody? You look at them. You make eye contact. It makes people close. So when you go and you ask a question, are you going to the hall? You look at them. You know, we go through. We go through. So make sure you're making eye contact. Also, what do you do when you talk to somebody? You physically orient to the person. It's not like, were you born in the fall? So again, we go through these very basic, and it seems basic, but to constantly remember. And also, when you're talking to somebody, I'm open to suggestions. I want to hear what you have to say. I'm open to suggestions. I want to hear what you have to say. I'm open. Sure. Talk to me. So that, and so watching your nonverbal, watching your behaviors. Are you open or are you open? So, and I'm pulling back, you know, somebody's talking to you. What do we do? So we go through all of that. So be aware. And so let's play bingo. And everybody gets up and keeping the activities very simple so you can concentrate on the social skills. So that's, and then on the back, on the reverse side, and then you can do the bingo with something in your class. Like if you're teaching language, you might put some cultural questions, or you might put anything related to your subject, just to get, and what I do, I watch the students. Everybody learns their names at the beginning of class, but I also watch the students to see their interaction. Because who's going to gravitate toward who? How are they getting along? Who looks like an aggressive one? Who looks like a quiet one? And also, that gives me an idea about forming teams. And if I see that may not be a match, then I might, I step in on that. But I watch that interaction, constantly watching the student interaction, just as they're doing this exercise. It's a simple exercise. And then on the back, I have some teamwork questions, which gets into the more personal nitty-gritty of the students answer these. This is what's fun, is they actually answer this. Yes, I get angry fast. Yes. And what this is a way of saying it's okay to be who you are and to try to be aware of some of the things that are that's going to come up in teamwork. And I put that, after going through the syllabus, that yes, we're going to have teamwork in this class. And this is just some of the reasons why I put these questions on this other side of the bingo, so that they know why we're playing this other side of the bingo. That it's important to know how you are when you work with people. And so to try to be aware of that. But when you're playing bingo, yeah, I get angry, okay, well, yeah, I'm sensitive, yeah. So things like that for students to be aware. So that's one. That's a technique that you can use in your class if you're going to be using teams to start letting them know how they can work together. Second one, and this one we're going to actually do it. This is a questionnaire. I let y'all all take a second and stop the questionnaire. Okay. Oh, thank you. Taking care of your team. That's great. All right. Okay, good. If y'all can just take a second, it's just front and back, and then figure out. What this is another innocuous, non-threatening way to start learning about other people in the classroom.
Should we take it now?
Oh, please.
Okay.
gonna show this.
Okay, okay, that works. How do I X this? Okay, that's it. Okay, but this was something. Okay, sorry. Okay, good. All right, how did I?
Do you want to? Yeah,
oh,
that's right there.
I had a Adobe and it wasn't working.
Oh, okay.
Okay, I can just. Is there a way to show this and just.
To make this full screen.
That's okay. I think I can. Okay. Oh, there. Is it full screen? It is.
Yeah,
full
that's
screen.
As big as the
screen. Okay,
yeah, actually. Sure. Okay.
That's fine.
If it's easier, you can just rip off that rating sheet and go through that to find out what type you are, or what's your dominant. After you've circled and found there's a handout, and we'll go over it in a second. Let me go ahead and move toward this. This tool is to learn about different learning styles, and VARC stands for visual learners. A is for oral, R is reading, and kinetic.
Learn by doing.
And this is a handout that goes, and there is, if you go on Google, you can get, there's a PDF, and I also put a PDF on the Blackboard site. So if you want to use this. What this is that people have different strengths and preferences for how they take in and learn. And let me hear what y'all's thoughts was. We have visual, where seeing have to have lots of visuals to take in information, like maybe if you're writing, drawing notes, and doing outline. There is oral, which by hearing, you should be good at taking, listening during lectures, maybe liking music. Writing, having to write it down in order to learn. And then kinesis, doing, learning by doing. And what I usually do is we don't have a blackboard here or anything, but I write it on the board and I put V-A-R-K, and then we put down everybody's name under. And what was dominant? What was your dominant?
Visual.
Visual?
Mm-hmm.
Visual.
Fairly oral.
Oral.
Mm-hmm. Visual.
Visual.
Reading.
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 Visual.
Reading.
Visual.
Oral.
Judy?
I'm still adding.
Still adding.
Pretty much even, but reading slightly.
Reading. Okay. Well, if y'all haven't guessed, mine is K. Do the right doing. But the whole point of putting that up is seeing that everybody is different. Everybody has different learning styles and preferences. And so what does that mean if the students are going to be doing a presentation?
Some are going to be more interested in one style, and some are going to not connect to that at all and want to do it a different way. Or
so if the student is going to, if the student presentation, if they all stand up and just do a reading or do an oral, it's not going to be, they're not going to hit a good part of the class that's visual. They're not going to get me, because I like to do. So, and I put that up there so that they know. So when they do their presentation, everybody's different, so you want to make sure that you hit all their different styles. And also, another reason of doing the bar is not only for presentation, but the big underlying message in Teams, we're all different. And this is a way of talking about differences in a non-threatening way. That we learn differently and we present differently. And so this is a thing, it exposes the students to the big hurdle in Teams. Well, this will come back to, is everybody's different. And they're assume that they're going to be different from you. And I did this one, I was just looking for shapes. And usually when they show teams, they're all little circles and they're all joined. No, they're not all little circles. You've got the dominant one, and this is the problem, the biggest problem after trust and learning that, is what do we do about the dominant one in our team that wants to take over? That no matter what, they're going to have the first answer out. The second one is the quiet one. What about the one we can't get anybody to say anything? Like we have a team meeting and they're just quiet. Then we have the aggressor that wants to get the way, gets their way. Then we have the aloof is, don't get close to me. My schedule's booked. I'm fully booked. Don't talk to me. And this one, the happy one, is we can all get along together. We can get along. It's great. Everybody's happy. Well, how's the team? Oh, it's wonderful. And you've got the aggressive, it's bad, it's horrible, the team is falling apart. And so, so the next thing that we do with our teams is we've got the thing that everybody's different, but how do you talk to the dominant one? We've got to make space for everybody in team. And the quiet one, your work is very valuable. So that's where we move into. We know about differences, and we spend the whole class going through different. We've got talking about differences. And the big thing that we start with is Lamesis, and this is, let me see on your thing, the green. Lamesis rules. And this I got from a friend. Lamesis rules of our game, because I like people to listen to me, I'll listen to others. Because I don't want anyone to say my ideas are stupid, I won't say that about anybody else's. I don't want people to make fun of the way I feel, so I won't make fun of other people's feelings. I don't want to be disturbed when I think things out. I don't disturb others. I want people to be a good audience for me, so I'll try to be a good audience. Because I don't like being left out in the group, I'll include others in my group. That was the mesis. When we get into a group, not only do we pick a name to get our sense of identity, we develop an understanding of how we're going to work together. And so that's what I have, that's the next thing that we do in teams, is what's going to be your modus operandi? How are you going to agree to work together? And then this is where I go through some dimensions of team dynamics. And we run through this, and then we let the students, the teams, come up with how they're going to work together. And to highlight two dimensions of teams. One is task leadership. And on here, but the thing, there's a bunch you can find on the Google internet and that, tons of stuff. Task leadership is getting the job done. And for this, it's productivity. The focus is on productivity. It's problem solving. It's moving the team along, taking charge. And this is what students tend to focus on, and do you know why? I mean, it's pretty funny. That's what this professor is focused on. We want a good presentation. Make sure that you're covering these points. Make sure that you include this. Make sure you refer to the reads if you want to get some outside. Making sure there's strong oral delivery skills. This may be good for getting the job done, but an important dimension is, and this is the second one, the leadership dimension, the socio-emotional. This is getting along. And in a teamwork, in a group dynamic, you have one person taking charge. In a teamwork, and this is the students, everybody in the team knows it, it's shared leadership. You and your team are responsible for not only productivity in your team, but a positive team spirit. So are you playing that role? So emphasizing to the students that I'm not just grading, and you'll see the rubric that's later, I'm not just grading on your product, I'm grading on your team dynamic. And how do I know that there's a good team dynamic? Again, going back to synergy, there's creativity, there's innovation, there is a positive team spirit. There is an energy that when that group comes up to present, they are excited and we're all excited. Your creativity is dynamic. And so that comes by the team paying attention to the two types of leadership. Another aspect, and And when I go over this, I just take a sheet like this, I think it's cooperative learning, and the students are there, and they're trying to identify, wow, do I do that? Have I done that before? And I could do it here, and I should have done it here, but I'll do it in the next one. Do you require that in your, when you do your team dynamics? Think about, do you require that? Are you stressing both of that, both dimensions of the task dimension and the social dimension? Have you thought about that? Yes, no, maybe so? But to stress that and include it in the rubric. The other thing that's in putting together that team dynamic are roles and responsibilities. Roles and responsibilities. And you'll see that from 3 to there's a flip side. And I'd like you to just look over that. And y'all have been in committees and teams. And what is your strength among yourselves that you can just look them over and identify in your group what you think your strengths are? And it can be also, I want to the leadership. So if you can just look over roles from and leaderships from 1 to 10, I don't think we have any 10s here, but... what would you identify and share among your team that you think is your strength? What is your strength? And this is within your group.
What do you think about when you initiate teamwork and after the teams are formed, giving this to the team to discuss or at least read their
That's
first time.
Exactly what I do. After the team
so
is formed.
So it's no games. Everyone knows there are different rules, and some of them can be destructive, like
they all know that.
Follower.
And they're all in a group, and they're discussing which one is their strength. Just like I would like y'all now to discuss among each other, what is your particular strength? Because we all bring a particular strength to a team, and we all play different roles at times. And to try to vary the roles. Did y'all?
No worries.
Self-centered follower. probably the questioner.
it's a good role. You're, what do you call, double devil?
They're all good roles.
But not necessarily also have the work ethic, right? I think you're
well, but it's different than questions. Usually just to verify, right? Double advocate, you want to make sure Something negative. Are they being negative? Or do they really truly?
Yeah, negative seems like it doesn't sound good. We'll step into that.
I have a challenge.
Yeah.
I have a challenge. As a group, discuss what you're going to do with the dominant. If you've got somebody with dominant, how are you going to tackle it? Because we all have a tendency, especially when we get passionate about an idea, to assert ourselves more. How will you handle dominant in your group? Go ahead and discuss. And also, feel free to freely admit if you can really get passionate about something and take that dominant.
Why are they being dominant? However, if you're in the group and other people who may be dominant and just a few of them,
so then they had to
tell you as a non-dominant member. Which one of these people would be best at dealing with it?
I'm a mature enough, so it may be hard for me to
in front of the group or
no one else
privately.
How do you handle dominance?
See your gender balance.
Everybody should mention it about the same sort of thing. So maybe if you see that,
that would
happening, that you say, okay, these are the roles that need to be filled in your group so that everybody has a specific role and nobody can really take over.
Okay.
Or they're not.
So that we do have all roles to play. And one of the things is we want to make a safe space so that people feel comfortable. So maybe I have somebody sitting on the side who's going to be the reporter. And you know, I do this exact thing. What I do is we go through the roles, but another thing that because we practice what the roles do, I just take a picture or some crazy little thing I get off the internet and say, okay, come up with a headline for it. And they have to talk about something very simple. And then I have one of the students volunteers to be the reporter to see how people are playing different roles. Mm-hmm. And then they talk about the observations that they make. Another thing I found that the students love playing roles. And so I deliberately asked, I want you to be the dominant one. And then for y'all to try to negotiate your way into the project. And your goal is to be dominant. And so the students work out. But the biggest thing is bringing them into awareness. How do you handle dominant? You bring it into awareness. Which the other thing, is the quiet one. When I talk about with the students, if you're dominant, that's great. is just to be aware. And so making space. As a team maker, as a team player, again, you're responsible. Shared leadership. You're responsible for task and for positive. And if you're being dominant, to be aware of that and make space for other people. Which, I was just going to say, what do you do about the quiet one? Again, it's shared leadership. And so you want to try to physically make space, mentally make space, and what else can you do? Not only do you make space, what do you do? As a teacher, what do you do if there's somebody quiet?
You can encourage the other members here to bring them in, I guess.
Exactly. We didn't hear what Lisa had to say. What about Joey? Joey didn't talk it. As shared leadership, it is your responsibility to monitor your team and ask. And the students assume that role. It's because they're going to be graded, too. When we get to rubrics, you're going to be graded on not just what you present, but how you conduct your team. And this is a chance to build team skills. Yes.
We've been talking about the gender issue. I know I've seen it still. Are you going to address that?
Of the females being quiet? Or the...
Yeah. More, I mean, depends. When I've taken classes at SIS, which...
Mm-hmm.
was predominantly female in the classes I took,
mm-hmm.
wasn't an issue.
Mm-hmm.
In COGUD, you have more males, so it depends on the school, on the class, on the culture.
But it's also in the person, but that is that, again, we're doing a team, and it's shared leadership. Everybody in that team is responsible. Also, I assign books, and this is one that the student assigned to me. They told me about this one. I hadn't heard about it. It's too big, but it's called Quiet, The Power of Introverts in a World That Can't Stop Talking. And the student came and recommended this. She said, this would be a great book for one of the teams. I am assigning this very, very short book. It's called Be Big. Be Big, Step Up, Step Out, Be Bold. Daring to Do Our Best Work Together. And it's a very quick read. It's about me, it's about you. It's about me going from small to big, about me making space for you to be big, and how the ways about how I try to keep you small, and then about how we can be big together. So, and also I'll tell you a thing, we do group exercises. This is another thing that I recommend. We practice on these. But the big thing is the shared leader, making the students and ourselves aware of the shared leadership and the different roles. And just constantly bringing it up. So that's what I'd like to do next, since because of our time, and I'm running through things, and sorry about that a little bit, because we got to run through. I think there's a yellow sheet. Yes. We don't all work in teams, but we get assigned committees. And what I'd like for you to do on this one is, everybody has separate pages. I was going to have just for one team, one paper per team, And if y'all could agree, have one person to be, y'all, just one paper that you're going to fill in, come up with two. For each, two points, it can be anywhere between 2 and 5 points for each, or like what was your worst committee and why was it bad? What makes a horrible, horrible committee experience? And then your second, wow, that was not us of that committee to be on? And why was that a positive? Why was working with those group of people positive? And so if you can, if y'all can do this as a team, if y'all can do this as a team, just one paper, and try to come up with between 2 and 5. What was it? And if you haven't been on a lot of committees, God bless you. Working with people. And it can be, you know, I don't want to say the white banner, but any place where you have to work with people, working with children. If you're getting an idea of what you like and dislike, but
were like some of the
like you to flip the page over when you're ready and come up with your own rules of your team. If you can just come up with three, how will you as a team, and we're going to pretend that y'all are going to be with each other for the rest of the semester, or the rest of the class, how will you, what would be your rules of your team? What would you like to pledge to each other? That how, what would be your mission together? How you'll be with each other? Mm-hmm. So if you got three, and to think about, based on what you like and dislike, how would you be?
And looking at what we're bad and good, and what you're kind of having your rules about communication and collaboration,
I've gotten so I know how to use it. I'm so proud of myself.
Okay. I just wanted to make sure.
This is what, actually, I have, it's not going to go back. These were away teams. I had teams that they had, there were assigned in their class, where that they're going to do their group project, but then they also had, I had sessions where we worked in class. And this is just to share with them. They did study guides. I'm sorry, this is not acting right. But anyway, it's going to come. They had to do a thing of, they're doing their
Can you pull that?
Yeah.
All right.
Sorry.
Thanks, Bill. What they did was they did exactly what y'all did. They put what they liked, what they disliked, and then they gave themselves a name. This was the Bumblebee team. And it's okay. This was the Bumblebee team. And this was them working together. You know what? I thought I put. And they're working together on different things. And this was their. This was what we'll try to do, what they dislike, and what they. They put what they dislike, what they like, and then they came up with what they want to try to do together. This was our blues and pinks. And this was at the end of the course. I asked them to do a study guide on teams. And it was 7 pages, 7 concepts, 7 skills. And they had to have a cover where they had their picture on it. And this is them working, and this was what they put. Sorry. And this is what they request, what they like, dislike. Their teams, this was it. That's fast, but what they liked, what they didn't like, and our so that's why I don't. So, because I want to give y'all time and I want to go over some other things, I mean, just here on the rubrics, I want to try to end on my formal presentation with what I left when I left off and with the class. Don't save. All right, where is it? The
previous one that you
were
on?
The YouTube.
Oh, okay.
Or where I was.
Oh, we're in the PowerPoint?
Mm-hmm. It's going to come up. So I showed y'all the thing, and then the student away teams, and thank you for this formal thing. And this is, oops, stop. This was the way I ended the class. We do the takeaways on reflection in every class. Final one, and I put together a presentation, or it's a little clip on scenes from their presentations, their class presentations. And their assignment was to take a book, and that was the thing, they had to take a book and to bring that book to life. And it would be an hour and a half presentation on a book with covering the important concepts. And they were to bring that book to life for their students, for their classmates. And again, there were visual learners, auto learners, kinesthetic learners. So to bring that, to make sure they covered all the different learning styles. They were allowed, they had to rehab 5 meetings throughout the semester. Only 3 of those meetings could be devoted to their team presentation. And at each team meeting, they had to have a different team leader. So everybody would be in charge of sharing leadership. And at each team meeting, they had to do an exercise. And I required this book, but I told them they could get it off the web. They could get any team building exercise. And the reason is to make sure that the students were paying as much attention to getting the job done as getting along. So I made sure that everybody had their meetings with a team exercise. So, and on our thing, we had Maxwell's, and the first team went on carnival rides. They put together a carnival, and different rides were different skills and concepts from the book. And by chance, they just happened to have a slip glider, or whatever those things are called, on the quad on the day of presentation. And they said, can we go ride it? And I said, yes, that's a team bonding. And I had no idea, but we went out, and we actually rode the glider. And it was that kind of spontaneity of going along with team dynamics. The next team presentation was on crucial conversations, and for that, they put together a hospital. They created a hospital that they were, and we were all hospital interns, and we had to report to the hospital, and it was called Joyful Dolphin, which was my nickname for the class. We each had to come up with an animal and an adjective, and I was the joyful, so they put together the Joyful Dolphin Hospital that we reported to, and we were team interns. Then another one was, we had getting along with how to deal with difficult people. We had how to deal with difficult people, so they made it into a MTV reality show. And so we were had to deal with different personalities. We had another one which was Geek, Team Geek. And so they thought that went along with the Olympics. So they created the Olympics and taught us different sports for different team activities. And we had the torch relay, and we got gold medals. And then the final one was building competent teams. And what they did for this, they actually went on, they had this, where was it? If I have it here, we got boarding passes. We had to line up outside the door. We got our boarding passes. We checked our baggage at the, there was a baggage thing where we checked all of our books. And they had all of the rows were lined up. Attention to detail. They had lighting down the aisles. They got little Christmas tree lights and put it down the aisle for our aisle. Then we had a plane crash, which they had a YouTube video, plane crash, our plane crashed in the jungle. So we were caught in the jungle, and then we had all team exercises to get out of the jungle. So that was the creativity of what students can do. Can we get that going? And so, yes. My doctoral student who does videos put together this piece, and I took pictures. We were documenting all throughout because we were so amazed at what everybody was doing. And it has music? Oh. I think to go back. Uh-oh.
Second. There we go.
Okay. If we can start at the beginning?
Yep. Yeah.
That was out on the quad, and that's my students, and they hooked me into it.
Required to be in everything. This is bobsledding. Yes, I'm back there on the floor bobsledding. We got our gold medals. Get out of the jungle. This is guiding them through love.
airplane, and we had to fix the chairs back together. So that is their thing, and this is some from there that they had. This was they took the concept, and when we came to get on the airplane, this was all from the book. They had different concepts from the book. So it was to bring it to life. So the creativity, and these were their final team of things where they put together their, so this was the creativity that can be brought out in terms of what they do with the students. So that was the basis of my presentation. I've gone through some other questions while we're going through, but are there other questions? This is where I wanted to have more of a discussion, but are there other
questions? I'm just curious because is there any studies or any, so my point is that if you're a teaching class, which is not about teaching, basically, you're teaching something, say science, they have, there is a big portion that's probably still an individual, but you want to bring some of the team elements and group elements into it. What would be a good ratio? Like, what point would, you know, this type of work become something that actually has an impact in creating a different classroom climate versus?
That's where I think it goes, I think I heard before, be very specific. What part is going to be individual? And if you want that part to be individual, to say it. And then if you want it to be team, what part to be team? And one of the things that I do, it's at the end, to let them know, this is interesting, which is in a class too, and I discover weird stuff that I do, that I do evaluations, that I'm going to evaluate on the individual, but I'm going to take into consideration what your teammates say when you're working in teams. And it's very, very simple. It's a very simple when I put for like getting the students' feedback. So yes, that's what I do. I'm specific on, and I would encourage you to be what for individual work and what for team work. What for individual work and what for team work. And what you want to give to that. I know there was another, I heard earlier questions on how do you assign? How do you assign?
Random?
I have a friend that said, I have a colleague that says, geography is destiny. And who's ever sitting in, that's your group, your group, your group. And when I have to do a fast random group, your group, your group, your group. Let's just sit here, your group, and job that way. Random?
When I teach a class, a lot of international students, I try to make a different country group. Like, no country is duplicated in each group.
Okay. Okay. Yes.
Topic of presentation. So, if you're interested in childhood obesity, you're going to be in this group. If you're interested in tobacco prevention, you're going to be in this group.
Yes, and that'll fit. There is a thing, I put it before, diversity creates synergy and new ideas and different perspectives. But it can also cause conflict. So it depends on what you gauge is the maturity of your students. If you think that they can handle diversity and work well, yes. I was reading, if with the younger and less mature, working with identity, they want to be like. It's important to not to have, if you've got five guys and only five guys in the class, to put one guy with each, you want to pair up and maybe have two guys, not to have them spread out. So that's the thing. It depends on the maturity and the comfortableness. And I just did the guys because in PC, we're lucky if you get five guys in a class. So that's the thing. Were there other questions? Yes.
What might be your advice? I'm looking for your advice when students approach you to you and then letting you know that I cannot work with all XX friend, YY friend, and they are so annoying and blah blah blah. And what might be my approach to address that issue?
Always, I ask the student about their skills because it's more than just liking on friends. It's people are going to be challenging. And so I'm looking at the students, are you challenging your skills? And what is it about that may be annoying? Or what may be challenging in working with the person? So to help the student see if there's another way to deal. If they can't stretch, that this is an opportunity to stretch and grow. And that's what I work with the student, that this is, and I have had that. And they've gone on to work with university clubs in conflict resolution because they worked through it. And they found it was a great experience in working through it. What about when you get several students come to talk about X students? And this is, usually I try to check in. I put like monitoring to find out how the team is going on before it gets to be a big problem. I've also read, and this is recently, right, I have to be honest, I haven't done it, the option of firing someone from a team. That when we form teams, that the team has the option of firing someone who is basically not doing the job, who's not showing up.
Is that over at the beginning or something that comes up?
In the beginning. I read it in preparation for this session, and I was doing the cooperative learning, that these researchers they'd actually tried this, and in their experience, it's counterintuitive. When the students know that they can fire somebody, and they realize that they can be fired themselves, they tend to make sure that that doesn't happen to them. It's like getting voted off the island. They work harder on that. My own personal thing, and the reason I'm hesitant, is I go, to me that kind of sets up, if we get a problem person in our team, we're just going to get rid of them. And because I teach team, it's important for me to know that, guys, you guys got to figure out a way to work it out. Yes.
Well, you didn't specifically talk about grading teamwork. And wouldn't grade be an incentive or disincentive for not participating?
Yes, but that's going to come up. But yes, I get that in the team feedback. And then I also have in the rubric of, I put that in team presentations, what I'm grading, and also in the syllabus, it's on there. And you know what, I think that there's going to be some but I think we have evaluations, but I want to thank y'all for being this is my first time doing it. So if y'all have appreciated constructive criticism, even unconstructive. And I hope you'll join me in the mission of bringing teams to AU and cooperatives to AU. So and also my email is somewhere.
And I'll take all your evaluations.